Morning, church family, and peace be with you. Please stand with us. Here at Sojourn East, we begin each of our services with a time of adoration to God, our Father, who is full of love and full of compassion. The prophet Isaiah says, "Though the mountains be shaken and the hills be removed, my unfailing love for you will not be shaken, nor my covenant of peace be removed, says the Lord who has compassion on you." Amen. This morning, God is inviting us into his covenant of love and peace through Jesus Christ, and he is inviting us to learn from him how we can experience love and peace with one another in this community. And so let's set our minds on the love of God as we worship him together.
Glory be to our King. how he filled me with the Holy Ghost, how he healed me to the uttermost. When I think about the Lord,
picks me up.
How he picked me up, turned me around, how he placed my feet,
set our feet upon the rock,
on solid ground.
When I think
about the Lord, how he saved me, how he raised me, how he filled me with the Holy Ghost, how he healed me to the uttermost. When I think about the Lord, how he picked me up and turned me around, how he placed my feet on solid ground, it makes me want to shout. Hallelujah, thank you, Jesus. Lord, you're worthy of all the glory and all the honor and all the praise. It makes me want to shout. Hallelujah, thank you, Jesus. Lord, you're worthy of all the glory and all the honor and all the praise. Lord, you're worthy of all the glory and all the honor and all the praise.
Amen. Praise God.
In Jesus, God has delivered us from the grip of sin and death and has called us into a life of love and of action. As imperfect people, we often fall short of this calling, and we allow our love for God and for each other to grow cold. We read in God's word, "If I speak in the tongues of men or of angels, but do not have love, I am only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have faith that can move mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give all I possess to the poor and give over my body to hardship that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing." Let's pray together. Father, the only reason we can love you or our neighbor is because you first loved us. You have called us to love, but our love has grown cold. We confess that we spend our time making so much noise, slandering one another, arguing over nothing, flattering and manipulating each other, but we forget to love. Revive our love for you, O God, and revive our love for one another. Remind us of your greatest commandments, to love God and to love our neighbor. Let the love of Christ be present in our hearts and our hands, our thoughts and our deeds, as we serve you. Amen.
Thank you. Father, for your promised blessing, still we plead before your throne. For the times of sweet refreshing, which can come from you alone. Blessed foretaste you have given, but in these we would not rest. Blessing still in, you are hidden. Pour them forth and make us blessed. Prayer ascending to you ever, answer Father, answer prayer. Let's all bless each weak endeavor, blood bought pardon to declare. Wake your slumbering children, wake them.
John 3 says, "See what great love the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called children of God." And that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know Him. Dear friends, now we are children of God, and what we will be has not yet been made known. But we know that when Christ appears, we shall be like Him, for we shall see Him as He is. All who have this hope in Him purify themselves just as He is pure. Amen. This morning, God is inviting each of us to remember the great love that He has for us in Jesus Christ. The perfect Lamb of God was slain and resurrected for our sins, that we might be called friends and children of the Most High. And so let's lift up this song of assurance and celebrate the purifying love of the Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you. His amazing love in Jesus. Amen.
Yeah. Yes, the amazing love of God has been revealed to us in Jesus Christ and has given us abiding peace in a world full of chaos. Please take a few moments to greet those around you in the love and peace of Christ.
Good morning. I'm Lindsay, and I'm on staff here at Sojourn East. And this morning, I have a few announcements for you, particularly about Vacation Bible School. And that is coming up soon, and we're super excited. We want to let you know that VBS is one of our biggest outreach events of the year. It really is kind of a week-long event. It takes lots of work, but we are so excited to do that because not only is it something really special for the families and kids right here at Sojourn East, it is a great opportunity for us to invite friends from the neighborhood, friends from school, all over the community to be a part of what's happening here at Sojourn East and to teach them about the love of Jesus. And so we're super excited, but as I said, it's a big event, so it takes lots of hands, and here's where you come in.
What's all this I hear about people pitching in for VBS?
Can I help you? Who are you?
Who am I? I'm Karen. I'm the assistant to the foreman, PJ McToolbag.
Okay, that name sounds a little familiar. What are you doing here?
Well, I've heard that this VBS project is called Under Construction, right?
Yeah, that's right.
Well, nobody knows more about building stuff than McToolbag Construction. We can't have a bunch of amateurs out here teaching kids how to build stuff up. That's for the seasoned professionals like us.
Okay, it's coming back to me now. Big, bushy mustache, long hair. He came in kind of like this a few weeks ago. Is that right?
Yeah, that's him.
Yep. Okay, so normally, you know, one person is enough to do the job, but now he's also sending you. Why are you here?
Well, he had an unfortunate accident with his arm in a cement mixer, so he's healing.
Okay, well, that's not great, but I guess what you're trying to tell me is that you are one man down?
Well, we're actually a few men down because of this unfortunate accident with Mr. McToolbag, but I'm not supposed to say much about that. Let's just say we put a lot of McToolbags in every square inch that we pour.
Okay, Karen, I don't know a ton about your operation or construction, but I do know about deadlines and about manpower. People power. And I know that we need a lot of people power for this event. We've got to have people who are willing to prepare snacks, people who are willing to work with crafts, people who are willing to do music and even security. So we need a lot of people power to make this happen. And if it doesn't, then the whole thing's going to fall apart. Now, I know that you're the assistant foreman, but...
No. Assistant to the foreman.
Okay, noted. Are any of the people on your crew going to be able to be here to help make this happen?
That's June 13th through the 17th,
right? Yep, that's right.
Ooh, looks like we're all booked.
Okay, so... If you don't mind, I'm going to finish talking to the people who might actually be helpful in this situation, and you can go back to Mr. McToolbag and wish him well.
Yeah, I'll have to report this to Mr. McToolbag because this is very unusual.
Thanks for that. Well, as you can tell, we are pulling out all the stops for Vacation Bible School, and we would love for you to be a part of it. So like Karen said, it is June 13th through the 17th, and we have made it really easy for you to volunteer. If you go on the What's Happening page, you're going to see a button that says Servant Registration, and there are lots of jobs, something for everyone. So we would love for you, if you're available, to join us that week. Not only is it such a blessing to get to serve alongside other sojourners, but it is really sweet to get to pour into the next generation and show them all about Jesus. So we'd love for you to join us. As we come to our time of giving, this is a chance for us to reflect on really our perfect model of servanthood, and that's Jesus, who humbled himself and put on flesh and came down to serve among us so that we would be reconciled to God. And so God's invitation to servanthood is also for us, and we get to participate in the work that he's doing. And one way to do that is by giving. So if you call Sojourn East your home, if you're a member or a regular attender here, this call is for you. If you are visiting with us, we hope that this service is a gift to you. Our scripture this morning comes from 2 Corinthians 2, 14 through 16. And if you're able, would you please join me in standing for the reading of God's word? But thanks be to God, who always leads us as captives in Christ's triumphal procession and uses us to spread the aroma of the knowledge of him everywhere. For we are to God the pleasing aroma of Christ among those who are being saved and those who are perishing. To the one, we are an aroma that brings death. To the other, an aroma that brings life. And who is equal to such a task? This is the word of the Lord. You may be seated.
Well, good morning. Peace be with you. If you're visiting with us this morning, my name is Kevin, and I have the privilege of serving as the lead pastor here, and I want to thank you for joining us. Before we get into this morning's message, I want to invite you to join me in prayer. Father, we thank you that you are a God who speaks to us through your word, and your word, it's challenging and convicting, and it's also comforting. More than anything, it's true, and it's good, and it's beautiful. So I pray this morning, as we come to your word, that I would be faithful to you, my words would honor you, and that we would be challenged, comforted, convicted. More than anything, that we would grow in our knowledge of you, your love for us, and your desires for us in this world. We ask these things in Christ's name. Amen. Well, I want to begin by asking you to grab a pen or opening up the notes app on your phone, or if you don't want to do any of that, you can just do it in your head. But we want to play a quick game. I want to play a quick game with you of just fill in the blank. And the blank I want you to fill in is life is, and then whatever comes to your mind. Life is what? And I imagine for some of you, life is good, maybe. Because school's almost over, it's vacation time, out of COVID, you're like, things are going pretty well. Right now, life is good. Others of you, it might be, no, life's still pretty hard and challenging. Or maybe life's confusing. Maybe you've put down exhausting. Maybe you didn't put anything down because you didn't know what to put down. Or maybe you chose a metaphor. If you're my age, you grew up in my generation, I can't hear life is without saying a highway pretty quickly afterwards because that was a song that was on repeat a decent amount in my formative years. Maybe you think of life more as a journey or an adventure. Or maybe you think of life, it's more of a competition. Life is a game that you've got to win, or it's a battle and there are good guys and bad guys. Or maybe, you know, the classic, we all know, it's like a box of chocolates, right? And we just, who knows what's coming around the corner. I think the last few years have felt like that. But all of us, I'm convinced, all of us, because life is mysterious and it's hard and it's wonderful and it's confusing and it's unpredictable, all of us, we have one or two or three lenses through which we view life to try to make sense of it. Maybe it's sayings handed down by our grandparents, but when life gets challenging or difficult or we don't understand, we have these sayings that we can revert to in this way of viewing life and trying to make sense of it. Well, in today's passage, which is coming from 2 Corinthians, and if you're new to the Bible, 2 Corinthians was a deeply personal letter that the Apostle Paul wrote to a church he planted. And there was a lot of conflict between Paul in this church. There were accusations that were lobbed against him that he was weak, he was unimpressive, that he was anxious, or he didn't follow through on his plans. And so he writes this letter attempting to explain, one, his understanding of Christianity and what Christ has revealed to him, and to challenge some of the assumptions that they had about Christianity. Now, in these three short verses we're looking at today, Paul, he offers two interconnected metaphors by which he's explaining what the life of a disciple of Jesus looks like. This is his filling in the blank. Life is. These two metaphors. And For the original readers of Paul's letters, they would have understood the metaphors because they were pointing to something common in their day that's not so common in our day or not common at all. So it's going to take us a little bit of work to really understand what Paul was saying in order to understand what he's saying to us today. The first metaphor, so we're going to just camp out on these metaphors and press in and say, what does this teach us about life with God here? The first metaphor is in verse 14, where Paul says that we are led in Christ's triumphal procession. Now, you've probably heard of the Pax Romana, the Peace of Rome, and you probably know that that peace came through a lot of war and a lot of conflict, and that Rome, the way they rose to dominance in the world was not just by winning, but after they would win battles or wars, they would like to throw these massive celebrations to just demonstrate to the world how incredible Rome really was. And so after any major battle or war, there would be a parade. And parade is, it's not a big enough word for what it was. The Macy's Day Parade was nothing compared to what this was. The parade would begin, and at the very front would either be the victorious general or the Caesar at that time, and they would be in this grand chariot that would be drawn by horses. Sometimes the chariots would even be drawn by elephants, and then behind them would be this train miles long. The whole city would be out on the streets. Everyone was kind of mandatory attendance. And in this train of the parade, they'd be cheering, celebrating Rome's victory. Following behind the general would be the soldiers who fought valiantly. They would have wagons that would have depictions of important moments in the battle and dioramas and actors kind of acting out the great scenes from the battle. There would be wagons filled with all of the silver and the gold and the fancy stones that were seized as the spoils of war. Behind that, there would be priests, the pagan priests, who would be waving incense to the gods, celebrating. And at the very end of the procession, so you'd be sitting there and you'd watch it go by, and you'd tell your kids, you know who that is, and everybody clapping and cheering. And then at the very end of the procession would be the soldiers, the enemy soldiers that were captured in war. And they would be drawn through the parade. And at the end of the parade, those prisoners would be put to death or made to fight in the Colosseum, where they would die. And the aim of this entire grand ceremony was, in essence, to declare to the world that Rome is the greatest. Now, Paul is saying, I'm going to explain to you what Christianity is like. And he talks about how Christ leads a triumphal procession, that Jesus Christ, King Jesus, is the general who won the greatest war against sin, evil, and death. He's the one true king, and there is a parade that follows behind him. And this is an image that Paul uses on multiple occasions throughout his letters. But what's so interesting and what's so challenging, what I wrestled with for weeks in this text, is that Paul says that we're a part of that parade too as disciples of Jesus. But we're not the soldiers following behind him, cheering him on, who helped win the battle. We're not the priest waving the incense. Paul says that we're actually at the very end of that parade, that we're the prisoners who've been captured. Look at verse 14. He says, "Thanks be to God who always leads us as captives." We're the captives in the parade, in Christ's triumphal procession. And this is really challenging. And theologians throughout the centuries have actually tried to find a way to say, I think Paul just screwed up here. I think he got something wrong, because it's such a challenging image. The life of a Christian is being a part of the triumphal procession in the back as a captured prisoner. And you have to really sit with this. It's a bit of a reach. What's Paul saying here? Well, Paul isn't saying that we are enemies with God. He's saying that we were enemies with God. And that when Christ came, we were dead in our sins. We lived for ourselves, for our own selfish ambitions. We were God's enemies. And then through Christ's victorious death on the cross, we have been reconciled to God, and now we belong to him. And this is language, if you've read Paul, you know he uses again and again, that as Christians, we belong to God, we are his people, his servants, or to use Paul's favorite image, we are slaves of Christ. That's what it means to be a disciple. We have been captured, and we are his slaves. 1 Corinthians, he says, you are not your own. You were bought at a price. Therefore, honor God with your bodies. Now, this mindset saturates Paul's writings that to be saved by Jesus means that you're making a break with your old life. You're going away from being, you cease to be an enemy with God. You have peace with God. And now you are a servant of God. And that's challenging, but if you've been around church, this shouldn't be all that new. What is new and what is challenging, I think, in this text, is Paul says, not only are we servants or slaves of Christ, we also are being marched to our death. What do we do with that? And while that idea, it's not spelled out explicitly, it's certainly implied here, Paul does state it explicitly in 1 Corinthians, where he writes, for it seems to me that God has put us apostles on display at the end of the procession like those condemned to die in the arena. You know, the apostles, they were viewed by everyone as the greatest in the kingdom of God. And Paul says, yes, we're the greatest, I guess. But because we're the greatest, we are living lives that are marked by death. We're being put on display. Our lives, and when Paul speaks of death, that's a big word where he certainly means physical death, but it means more than that. It's kind of this catch-all phrase when Paul talks about death. It means physical death, but it also means dying to self and dying to your own desires. It means suffering. It means shame. It means hardships and heartaches. And Paul is saying that's what's in store for us as Christ's apostles. He explains, he continues, verse 11, he says, to this very hour, we go hungry and thirsty. We're in rags. We're brutally treated. We are homeless. We work hard with our own hands. When we are cursed, we bless. When we are persecuted, we endure it. When we are slandered, we answer kindly. We have become the scum of the earth, the garbage of the world. Put that on a bumper sticker, right? Maybe that could be our VBS theme in the years to come. Scum of the earth, garbage of the world. I'm joking. What is going on here? I mean, this is a really challenging passage, and I want to be clear. Paul doesn't view himself as a worthless worm. He knows he's loved by God. He knows that nothing can separate him from the love of God. He wrote those very words. But he also knew that a life of faithfulness to Jesus entails so much suffering and hardship and heartache and, you know, inner turmoil, so much death that the world's going to look at disciples of Jesus and say, who in their right mind would want to live in that way? They are the scum of the earth, the lowest of the low. Now, what's even more fascinating is Paul, he writes this and he doesn't say, this is just part of the cost. He doesn't say, there's great promises in the future, and this is just, you know, we have to take our lumps along the way, or this is the downside, the upside's coming. In verse 14, he says, thanks be to God who always leads us as captives. He's praising God for this. It's like, yeah, this is the way it is. It's great. Thank you, Lord, that death awaits us at every turn. Why? That's the question. Why? Why does he praise God for this? And the answer, it's right before our noses throughout the New Testament. It's obvious, and yet it's so hard for us to really receive. The answer is because Paul knew that the way God demonstrates his power in our lives is not usually through supernatural displays of his might, which is what the super apostles, Paul's enemies, would claim. Instead, the way that God demonstrates the power of his gospel in our lives is by strengthening and sustaining us in the face of great pain, trials, suffering, loss, brokenness, and death. We want from God the big, the miraculous, the powerful, the grand. But Paul knows that God, he works in the brokenness and the pain, that his, as he will write later, that his power is actually perfected in weakness. Now, I shared this a couple of years ago, and ever since I shared it, I've been thinking about it personally. I've been challenged by it. And so I wanted to bring it back to you. But Martin Luther, he kind of pulls on this thread that Paul's writing here in a work known as the Heidelberg Disputation. And it's hard to read, but feel free to Google it if you want. But in it, Luther contrasts two very different ways thinking about God and life. One of the ways we think about God and life, he calls the theology of glory. And that's not a good thing. And then if you hold to a theology of glory, what Luther says is that you just think that God is pretty much just like you, just a bigger version of you. You assume that what we treasure and value, God treasures and values. And so we like strength, and we like might, and we like power and influence. And so we assume that God does as well. We want life to be up and to the right, and so we assume that that's what God wants for our life as well. He says this is what has infected the church from day one, this thinking that God is just like us, just a little bigger than us, and he wants what we want. But what Luther argues is that the center of human history stands the cross. And the cross is not up and to the right. The cross, from a worldly perspective, is marked by loss, suffering, and death, and yet it's the greatest work of God in human history. King Jesus, to go back to Paul's metaphor, he's our victorious general, and he conquers us. But how does he conquer us? Not with violence or might, but with love. He achieves salvation not through a successful military campaign, but through incomprehensible suffering. And what Luther is saying is the work of the Christian life is it's not trying to bolt on what Jesus has done onto our life. Instead, it's getting a whole new vision and understanding of how God is at work in our world. And at the center of that vision is the cross. Because at the cross, God's power was demonstrated in weakness. His victory came through defeat, and life came through death. The cross turns everything we know about life on its head. And Luther argued that the cross, it wasn't just like one like hard moment in history, but God had to do that to achieve our salvation. Luther argues the cross is the ultimate demonstration of how God works in our world. He writes, God receives none but those who are forsaken. You want to be received by God, you have to be forsaken because of sin. He restores health to none but those who are sick, gives sight to none but the blind, and life to none but the dead. He has mercy on none but the wretched, and gives grace to none but those who are in disgrace. I would say what Luther's arguing, and even more importantly, what Paul is arguing is so challenging, it forces us to radically rethink our thinking. Luther had this saying, the cross alone is our theology, that God's power is perfected in weakness, and the way we experience real life is through dying. Now, this runs so counter to the way we tend to think about life with God. It's disturbing and it's unsettling. And I want to be clear, don't get me wrong, we have the victory in Jesus. I've read Revelation. We know how this all ends. We know where we're going to be with him in glory. We have many great and precious promises, but we still live on this earth that is filled with sin and brokenness. And God chooses, in his great wisdom, to use those things as a means by which he demonstrates his power. You know, crucifixion, it's woven into the fabric of the Christian life. It's how we become a Christian. You die to yourself. And then how do you grow as a Christian? You keep dying to yourself. Dying daily is the undeniable mark of the Christian life. Death, as Paul says. 1 Corinthians 15, Paul says, I die every day. We die to our sin. You know, and I think the first kind of stage of our spiritual journey when God saves us is we typically have one, two, or maybe more very obvious kind of sins or sinful patterns in our life, and we get to work by the Spirit of God. We get to work on those things. How can I grow? How can I stop doing these things and start doing these things, these other things as well? That's one thing we die to, but it's more than that. I think we die to our selfish ambitions. Kind of this idea that we've all been fed since we were little. Be whoever you want to be. It's your life. Do whatever you want. You follow Christ, you've got to die to that. Dying to the idealized notion of the life you were going to have or you thought you deserved. I mean, think about Paul. Paul, ever since he was a little kid, obviously, we know from his story, he was being raised so that he might one day be this incredible Pharisee. When he was a little kid, his mom and dad would say, Paul, someday you're going to wear that funny hat and those funny robes, and you're going to be at the very front, and you're going to be in charge. And he was, wasn't he? Remember, he brags about it. I was the Pharisee of the Pharisees. I was it. I was the one. I had the seat of honor. People loved me. I had money and influence and connections. My life was great. And then Jesus came along. And then I was despised and rejected. I had people hurling stones at me and whipping me and trying to put me into prison. In our life, part of that death is dying to this, the entitlement we have, or even that word, it's a loaded word these days, but just the things we expected or we wanted. Maybe it's a lifestyle you wanted or a group of friends that you thought you were going to fit in with or that you thought you deserved or you thought was your place that turned out not to be your place, a plan or a dream. But often God interrupts our plans and our dreams and he calls us to something different, and it's hard and it's unexpected. It's often painful. I think we also die to being liked by everyone. For some of us, this is one of the hardest deaths. When you think about Paul's life, what did he do? He went and served and told people about Jesus, and he was hated by many for it. I think another thing we die to, it's just our rights and our entitlements, what we deserve. I mean, look at what Paul said back in 1 Corinthians 4. He says, when we're cursed, we bless. People say horrible things to us, we answer with words of life. When we're persecuted, we endure it. We push through. When we're slandered, we answer kindly. When people say horrible things about us, when they lie about us, we don't go and say horrible things about them. We don't pay them back. Instead, we walk in kindness. Why? Because all of those things, they're little deaths, but it is in that dying that we bear witness to the grace of God and the power of God. When we don't feel the need to defend ourselves or to justify ourselves, we bear witness to the world that our God has got us. And he's got our back. And he's died for us. He's promised resurrection for us. And whatever we're experiencing now, we can endure because we know that he rules and he reigns. That's still a little abstract. Let's bring it forward, ground level, to our lives today. The last few years have been hard, particularly hard in the church. And there is a lot of chatter and a lot of discussion about what posture should Christians in America take at this moment. We are being more and more marginalized with each passing year. We're being unfairly represented. We're being called closed-minded because we hold to an understanding of what it means to be human and human sexuality, a view that was held by pretty much all people across all time for thousands of years until about 7 years ago when we got really smart and said, oh, that was all wrong. We finally figured it out. And the arrogance of the modern day, we feel that, and we feel pushed to the margins. And for us to hold the truths that we've always held to, it's becoming more and more unpopular. How should we respond? And there's a growing chorus of voices. They might not say it exactly, but they will say desperate times call for desperate measures. You know, what got us here won't get us where we want to go. Sometimes you got to fight fire with fire. And I'll be honest, sometimes in me I'm like, yeah, let's do it. Let's bring the hammer down. But what is that? That's that theology of glory. It's the trying to fight these battles in human ways. I think we often forget that when Jesus, or Paul in particular, he called us to love, to forgive, to show mercy and compassion, I think we forget that he was often writing those words as he was unfairly in chains in a Roman prison. He wasn't writing it, you know, living in his televangelist, multi-million-dollar home by the pool, you know, sitting there like, you know what, let's just be kind to everyone, life's great. He was writing it while he was starving, his back was hurting, and his feet were killing him, and he had wounds that wouldn't close. He's saying, no, we serve, we love, we forgive. We make sacrifices, we're generous. And in doing so, we bear witness to the power and might and greatness of our God. This is what makes the church unique. This is what makes us different. Everything else, like the entertainment, the political gamesmanship, you know, the grasping for power, you can find that in every corner of the world, in every group, in every party. What makes the church different is that we love, we serve, we sacrifice, we forgive, we embrace death because we know God meets us with power in our weakness. In the world, it doesn't have a category for this kind of behavior. That's what scum of the earth, some will say, because we're so distinct. But that distinctiveness is actually how God achieves his purposes. And so that's the first metaphor. The second metaphor won't take nearly as long. But I want to read the whole three verses once more. Paul says, "But thanks be to God who always leads us as captives in Christ's triumphal procession and uses us to spread the aroma of the knowledge of him everywhere. For we are to God the pleasing aroma of Christ among those who are being saved and those who are perishing. But to the one we are an aroma that brings death, and to the other an aroma that brings life. What Paul is saying here, and it's not really an illustration that I think we would use, but he's saying that when disciples of Jesus embrace a cross-shaped life of service and forgiveness and willingly enduring hardship and suffering, and we do it all, but we're praising God and we're faithful to him, we put off a polarizing, distinctive aroma. And to some, it's the aroma of life. To others, it's the stench of death. But it's the same smell, is what he's saying. It's not two different smells. It's the same smell. And I was trying to think of how to illustrate it because it's kind of confusing. But I was thinking about when my wife and I go and visit my mom. My mom's amazing on so many levels. She gave me life. She's been there for me for 40 years and counting. She's wonderful. But one of her great weaknesses is that she hates coffee. She despises it. She's always hated coffee. And my wife and I, we love coffee. We've actually discovered that brewing a cup of coffee for one another is the sixth love language that Gary Chapman missed in his book. And so when we visit her house, she doesn't have the necessary tools required to make a good cup of coffee. And so we have to pack our own stuff, bring our own cup. And when that first pot in the morning, if my wife wakes up before me and she starts brewing coffee, and I wake up to that smell is the aroma of life and vitality, the reminder that God's mercies are new every morning. You know, it's like, I've got strength for today. That smell, it's so good. There's nothing like it. But my mom, she smells it, and it's the stench of death. And I can see her fidgeting as the aroma fills her house. It's infecting her carpet and, you know, her couches and furniture. And she just, I can't stand that smell. You know, do we need to brew it outside next time? But either way, it's the same aroma, same smell. To some, it's the aroma of life. To others, it's the stench of death. And what Paul is saying here is that when disciples of Jesus embrace the way of weakness and of dishonor, trusting in his power, which specifically and practically looks like loving our enemies, turning the other cheek, forgiving those who have hurt us, showing grace to those who don't deserve it, praying for those who persecute us, when we no longer side with the powerful just because they're powerful, when we stop being impressed with money and stuff and status, but we willingly associate and even serve the lowly, the needy, and the broken among us, when we proclaim that there is no other name given under heaven whereby we can be saved, that we are all sinners. But Christ died for sins once and for all, and he is our righteousness. Paul says when we live in this way, we put off this polarizing aroma, and to some people, it's the stench of death. You know, Ted Turner once famously said that Christianity is a religion for losers. I'm like, well, you're kind of right, Ted. Yeah, we can't save ourselves. Left to our own devices, we aren't going to make it very far. No matter how hard I try, I do things I don't want to do, and I don't do the things that I want to do. My life is filled with weakness and brokenness. I rarely live up to my own standards. I've got all sorts of failures. I would be lost and helpless if it was not for the grace and mercy that God has shown to us. Yeah, I didn't win. You didn't win. At the heart of the Christian faith, the very first thing Jesus says is repent, which means whatever you were doing, you got to stop because I'm coming to tell you there's a different and better way. And to some people, they're going to look at that and say, man, they're poor, they spend all their time. Why don't they live the good life like we live? When we love our enemies, when we don't repay evil with evil, man, there are a lot of people who find that wholly unappealing. But to others, Paul says, when we embrace this cross-shaped life, we become the aroma of life to people. Which I don't know about you, that's one of the things that brought me to Jesus, and it's one of the great joys that God uses to keep me close to Jesus. It's other Christians who are very honest about their life and their weakness, who don't have it all together, who are able to say, man, I've blown it more times than you know. And I have failed, and I've fallen, and I've come up short. But God, all my life, he's been faithful. And he's been so good in the midst of it. There are some people who hear a message like that who are at the end of their rope, and they realize they don't have to keep holding that rope, that they can cling to Jesus instead. That's the way of the cross. And it's beautiful and it's powerful. And Paul says our job, we don't have to manufacture something. Like, all we have to do is embrace this way of life and proclaim this way of life and proclaim what Christ has done that's made it possible. And God's going to do his work. And I think as the church, as we're collectively saying, what does the future look like for us? Man, I see this pull again and again to the glory side. Like, we need more power and more influence. It reminds me of when I first got into ministry about 20 years ago, I guess. And it was because everyone gets into ministry at the age of 20, into student ministry. So we would do all these student events. And it was always like, man, maybe we could get 1,000 next time. What if we got 1,500 the time after that? Maybe we could get 2,000, and then we could rent out this big thing, and we could get this cool band. Maybe we could get Tebow, and he would show up. And I'm not hating on Tebow, but it was, what is that? It's like if we could do this grand event with some really popular and famous people, it's the way of glory, man. It's like just taking the world script and saying, that's how we're going to save the world, and it's never worked. And I'm not picking on Tebow or those people. I'm just saying it's not how God chose to work. He didn't pick the apostle who was the most eloquent or articulate. He picked Paul, which people said, he don't speak too good. You know, he's not all that impressive, all that powerful. He chose to demonstrate his glory in Paul and the rest of the apostles. Not by giving them an amazing life that was the envy of all their neighbors, but by leading them on that death march. And they really were. Every single one of them except for one ended up giving up their life. And yet here we are 2,000 years later, still learning from them and talking about them. So to bring this home, if you're here today and you're feeling weak, you're feeling overwhelmed, you're feeling not up to the task, you're feeling like you've failed and you come up short, you feel like you're not all that great at being a Christian, I want you to know, Paul would say, Luther would say, that's precisely where God loves to work. That hardships and heartache, suffering and weakness, they aren't obstacles that prevent us from growing in our faith, which we often think they are. We often think, man, if it weren't for all of this junk in my life and all of this pain and all this if it weren't for all of this stuff, man, my walk with Jesus would just take off. When the reality is, it's all of that junk and all of that hardship, that's actually the way that God humbles us, deepens us, and grows us in faith and trust. It's how God displays in us his power. This past week, my wife and I, we got to get away for a couple of days on a retreat with Harbor Network. It's a church planting network that we helped start about 10 years ago. There are about 175 pastors and wives there. And I felt like it was one big group therapy session after the last couple of years. Most of the pastors there, their churches all shrunk by 30 or 40% over the last few years. And just, I mean, sad, hard, painful story after sad, hard, painful story. But it was actually so encouraging because in the conversations, I didn't hear a single person say, man, I wish we could just get back to the way life was 3 years ago. If we could just get, not a single one. Instead, they said, you know, it's been horrible, but it's been so good. All of the pretense that I had, my grandiosity about how great I was going to be and I was going to plant the perfect church, my idealism, all of that pain, I've been brought low. But I have a much deeper love for Jesus and trust in Jesus because of it. So I don't know what it is in your life. And I don't want at all to minimize suffering or hardship and act like it's not real. I just want you to know, at the center of our faith stands this meal. And at this meal, we celebrate our Savior who said, this is my body that's broken. And it wasn't just a metaphor. And this is my blood that's going to be poured out, that's going to be spilled. And he gave himself for us to reconcile us to God, but then he actually invites us to follow in his footsteps. And so if you're here and you're a Christian, I encourage you to feast, to be reminded that no matter what life is throwing at you, what you're experiencing, God has not forgotten you. And even the really hard, horrible stuff, God is using in your life to grow you and deepen you. If you're here and you're not a Christian, we ask that you not take part in this meal, but you take part in the life that Jesus offers. It's a life of fullness filled with much joy and wonder and beauty, but also hardships, trials, and suffering, all of which combined to grow us in our love for him. Let me pray. Father, we thank you for your word that speaks truly to us, that offers us hope for the real world, where our lives are filled with so much that we don't like, that we don't want, that we want you to get rid of, that we pray and pray and pray and ask that you take away and you leave it there. And you leave those hard things in our life often because your grace is sufficient. Lord, I pray that you would continue this work of leading us away from the way of glory, leading us deeper into a life that is shaped by the cross, that is marked by forgiveness, compassion, honesty, humility, and love. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Thank you.
you stand with us?
In tenderness he sought me, so weak and sick with sin, and on his shoulders brought me into his flock again, while angels in his presence sang until the courts of heaven rang. Oh, the love that sought me, oh, the love that bought me, wondrous grace that brought me.
Service with a call to worship, and we end every service with a benediction, which is a blessing spoken over you as you go. If you'd like to receive this blessing, you can extend your hands with us. Sojourn, go now reminded that the chains of sin and death that once bound you have been broken, and that you have been set free to a life of love for God and love for those around you. Go in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Peace be with you. Thank you.
can justify a single wrong. My righteousness is Jesus' life. My debt was paid by Jesus' death. My weary load was borne by Him, and He alone can give me rest.
My conscience cleanse my